And I'm going to go ahead and get started here. So good morning. My name is Amanda Jarvis, and I'm with the Virginia SBDC Network. For those of you that are not familiar with our organization, the Virginia Small Business Development Center is a partnership program between the U.S. Small Business Administration, George Mason University, and local host institutions throughout Virginia. With 27 locations across the Commonwealth, we provide training and technical assistance to small businesses in their local communities. Our one-on-one consulting services are available at no charge. Today's webinar, Craft Beverage QA/QC, Best Practices for Safeguarding Product Quality, is presented by the Virginia SBDC Network. We are recording today's presentation and it will be posted on our website, virginiasbdc.org. Due to the large number of participants, everyone's microphone is muted today, but if you have questions during the presentation, you can type those into the Q&A box. We have also enabled the live transcript function, which can you can show or hide via your meeting controls. And now it's my pleasure to turn it over to our panelists for today's session.
Well, thank you so much, Amanda. Good morning, everyone, and thank you for joining us for this conversation about craft beverage quality assurance and control. My name is Chris Van Orden, and I'm the manager of the Craft Beverage Assistance Program at the Virginia SBDC at George Mason University. The Craft Beverage Assistance Program is designed to provide industry-specific technical assistance to Virginia's craft beverage sector. Today's program will be a free-flowing conversation touching on a range of topics associated with quality assurance and control for the craft beverage production sector. You can enter any questions you have in the Q&A function, and we'll do our best to either answer them in real time or at the tail end of the webinar. So today, I'm excited to introduce Audrey Skinner, a gastronomical chemist and founder of Imbibe Solutions, a quality control laboratory serving Virginia's craft beverage producers. Before founding Imbibe, Audrey earned degrees in chemistry and gastronomy and held several positions at growing Virginia craft beverage companies. Today, I'll be asking Audrey to share some of her expertise and insights for breweries, wineries, and cideries looking to implement or improve QA/QC measures. Welcome, Audrey.
Thank you.
So first of all, let's define some terms here. What exactly do quality control and assurance mean for the craft beverage industry?
So quality assurance is going to be your proactive process management. So making sure that you are following recipes, you're doing regular maintenance, like replacing soft parts, gaskets consistently so that you aren't having any errors from that kind of thing, conducting safety training, kind of everything that goes into the making of the product. Versus QC is going to be your product verification. So making sure that what you are producing actually meets your expectations for consistency and quality and stability. And it's not just at the very end, it's gonna start at the beginning with your raw materials, testing those, testing your product as it is fermenting, before bottling, after bottling, keeping a library so that you have things to look back on and troubleshoot. So process versus product quality is kind
that of- That is a very helpful distinction. I feel like people use the terms interchangeably, and it is good to know that the A versus C here. And so you touched on this a little bit already, but would you mind kind of going over what the goals of QA/QC are and for people who are interested in this space or interested in improving in this area, why is it an area to invest in if it's not necessarily driving more revenue?
Sure. So one of the biggest goals is to protect the money that you are spending to create this product. It's kind of like buying insurance to ensure that the product is going to meet your standards every time. To help you avoid any recalls or bad first impressions, you want to make sure that the first time somebody tastes your product, you are actually capturing them as a future customer and not just the one-time customer. It'll also help you improve your product and make it more competitive, right? Any large winery, large brewery, large cidery has their own lab in-house. So it's really important that the smaller producers can also kind of compete with them and make sure that they have these double checks. And then for beer and cider, making sure that you're producing a consistent product every time that's the same label, that'll really help with maintaining customers.
That is a good point. I think it's sometimes people don't do a great job of quantifying the risk associated with not doing these things. And once you sit down, anybody who's had to dump a batch or had a recall kind of feels that acutely. So trying to head that off is a very good idea.
Absolutely.
So I know you've worked with a number of companies, many companies on their QA, QC issues, and I won't ask you to share any horror stories or implicate any companies that you may have worked with, but would you mind kind of identifying what you find to be the most common QA, QC issues for sort of the major categories of beverage producers you work for? So breweries, wineries, and cideries.
Sure. Breweries and cideries, the biggest one I get is kind of those oh shit moments. The can is popping. We've had some microbial contamination get in. It's a pretty easy fix if you're doing regular micro testing. You can catch it before it gets out into market, and then you don't have to do that recall or that awkward social media post of everything needs to stay cold because things are popping. get a decent amount of those. The big reason it's happening is for beer and cider, you have the lower alcohol content. So you are more likely to be growing microbes in there kind of accidentally. Hops and beer certainly have the advantage of having some antimicrobial properties, but it's not perfect. There's certainly still hop resistant microbes, especially lacto and PDO. So regular testing will help with some of that. Another one for beer, inaccurate ABVs. They have such a tight window that they have to maintain. So for beer, you can only be plus or minus 0.3%. Wine and cider, you have a larger like whole percentage. But beer, very tight window. So you want to make sure if you have a new recipe, you're really double checking it and making sure it's working the way you think.
And then I should say on that front, anybody who is selling their product outside of Virginia, be aware that some states have even tighter windows. Mm-hmm. North Carolina has an even lower kind of band of tolerance on that front. So if you're interested in entering new territories, you may have to be that much sharper on your ABV.
And if you're exporting to Canada, they do check it. So you can't just slide in there and go like, oh, we'll fix the next one. They will check it at the border, and you will have to pay for return shipping. So that's a huge expense. The other one to be careful with in beer is hop creep. So there's been a lot of research in the past 2 to 3 years about hop creep. If you are dry hopping, basically the hops are introducing some enzymes that will kind of get your yeast going again. And so your ABV may increase a little bit. Then also with barreling, if you're barreling anything, there's probably a little bit of bourbon in there that you're really excited about. Well, that's going to up your ABV. And the higher you are in ABV, the more likely your plan isn't going to go quite right. You may be a little off. So mm-hmm. Worth checking ABVs for beers quite a bit. For wine, incomplete fermentations is a big one. I work with people who say they are listening to the barrels, they can hear the fermentation going, and when the barrels get quiet, you don't hear that bubbling anymore. They think fermentation's done, and they'll send us samples, and we will have to go back and say like, no, you probably have another 2 to 3 weeks on this before it's actually dry. Because if it's not dry, then you're leaving food for spoilage microorganisms to come in. So we want to make sure that we're finishing our fermentations, both primary and secondary. VAs, so acetic acid, volatile acidities, kind of all fall in there, is another one that I see a lot. So if you're doing regular monitoring for acetic acid, you can notice when it's going to start spiking, and you can do some preventative work to make sure that it's not gonna sour your wine. But if you're not, you're gonna suddenly go taste it 1 month and you have sour wine, and now you have to blend it down or get a sweet spotter, or
you got some vinegar in the works.
Yeah, not really what we want. So that one, and then The last one we probably see for wine is stability, heat and cold stability. You really do want to make sure that everything is stable before you are putting it into the bottle. For heat stability, doing a bentonite trial beforehand can take some of the guesswork out of how much you should add, because there's no golden rule. Some wines need more sometimes, some wines need less bentonite. Obviously, you don't want to over bentonite, because that strips out some of your flavor and your color and other things that you want to keep in there. But if you're not adding enough, then you bottle a product that's not stable. So doing those checks is very useful.
Yeah, that is. I know you're just scratching the surface there, but it is good to know that the most common areas to look out for, especially for younger companies who may be, you know, scaling up their QAQC measures. These are the kind of a good place to start. So
it's a lot too. It's a lot to try and keep track of.
Yeah. Yeah. It is difficult enough. It's always a minor miracle when a product comes out according to plan. Mm-hmm. Sometimes when you learn about how involved these processes can be, it's amazing that it ever works in some ways. Then again, that's why I'm not on the production floor. Kind of speaking about measures to put in place, are there any kind of baseline QAQC measures that you'd recommend that all producers, even brand new or very small scale producers, have in place? Something that you kind of say, this is the baseline.
For starters, I would say write SOPs. It's really easy to jump into having a company and you're just doing the work, but you've never actually written out your SOPs.
Mm-hmm. Standard operating procedures.
Standard operating procedures. Yes, thank you. For cleaning, for production, for, you know, following recipes, for packaging, pretty much everything in your facility should have an SOP for it, so that as you grow, you've already established how you want things done and everybody's getting trained the same way. You can go back and make sure that everybody's consistently following them. It's really easy for us to all get a little lazy and find the shortcuts, and then we train the shortcuts to the next person, and you know, it goes down the chain and suddenly we're not quite following the SOPs perfectly. So having established written SOPs is really kind of the top priority for any quality assurance program. That followed by making sure you're doing regular maintenance. So if you have pumps, pressure washers, packaging lines, hoses, you know, I know you're all using gaskets. Make sure that you are replacing them frequently. They do get worn out. As soon as they get a little tear in there, that's a really great place for microbes to grow. You can soak them all you want and clean them, but something's probably going to survive and get through. It also means you're not having a completely tight seal, so air is getting in there. That's not always great. So replacing soft parts. And depending on frequency of use, that could be once a quarter, once every 6 months, but absolutely at least once a year, replace those soft parts.
And that's one, it does not have to be an expensive fix. You know, there are certainly lots of ways to spend money on the production floor and on QA issues. You'll kick yourself if you have to dump a batch because you were not willing to spend or didn't take the time to replace a gasket. A gasket is maybe the cheapest item.
So cheap. Yeah. I mean, it's a pain in the ass, especially if you have a canning or bottling line and having to take everything apart to replace all the gaskets, but it is absolutely worth it. If you're in beer and cider, you're making sure that you're not getting extra oxygen in your package, including wine, those two and wine, you're not getting microbes in your package, because hopefully everything going in at that point has already been filtered and cleaned, and you want to keep it that way.
Absolutely.
I would also recommend getting a baseline chemistry for all of your products. So if it's the first time you're making a recipe, making sure that you are testing it out, making that it's going the way that you want it to be. And that way, every time you make it after that, you have some consistency. You can double check, you can troubleshoot and say, well, shoot, the alcohol came out a whole percent high. We can look back and see what happened. It'll also help you if you are a beer and cider, hiring new brewers, installing new equipment, you're getting a new batch of ingredients in that, you know, making your IPA this year is going to be the same IPA that you make next year with all new people, equipment, and ingredients. For wine, of course, you have a unique harvest every year. So you want to kind of get a baseline on your juice and a baseline at the end of fermentation. So if you do those two things, then if anything goes wrong after that, we can help you troubleshoot backwards and say, well, what was our starting point? You know, was the acetic acid high initially, or has something really changed and it's suddenly spiked? And then we can kind of try and pinpoint where that might have occurred. So that would be really good. Other kind of basic things for producers to have, I would say a really basic lab setup. Obviously you're gonna need hydrometers. All of you are having to measure density or bricks. So those are needed. A pH meter, which I'm gonna throw out, you really need to calibrate every day, if not every use. So I have to calibrate mine at least twice a day, morning and afternoon. I do notice it does start to drift. So if you're not calibrating daily, then you're probably getting some drifting occurring. A really good tip is if you have cream of tartar, and you put cream of tartar in water and measure the pH of that, it should always be 3.56. So in addition to using your buffers, you have kind of a internal standard that you can use to make sure that your buffers are still healthy and accurate. You will need to make that regularly. It does eventually grow mold, so that will throw it. But if you make it fresh, it should always be 3.56. But a pH meter is really useful for monitoring your fermentations or aging, and again, making sure that you aren't having some unwanted microbial growth in there. Which, speaking of microbes, a microscope, doing yeast counts is really important. So you'll need a hemocytometer. eBay is a great place to get a microscope and a hemocytometer, just a couple $100 for both. You can make sure that the yeast you are inoculating with is viable. You use a dye called methylene blue. So what the dye will do is it will go into all of the cells, and the live cells will process it and push it back out. But the dead cells are dead, so they can't do that and will stay blue. So when you look at it under hemocytometer, you can count how many are viable. And that'll give you a good indicator of whether or not you'll have a good fermentation. If you don't have enough viable yeast, and I'm talking like upper 90%, you will probably have a sluggish start to your fermentation, or maybe a sluggish entire fermentation.
Interesting. So, is that particularly important for people who might be pitching yeast from batch to batch as opposed to getting fresh lab delivered yeast every time?
Yeah, especially batch to batch, you want to make sure that it's still going. It'll be a good indicator when it's time to cut it and get a new prop. Or some people will get a prop from the lab and then hold on to it and kind of dose it out as they need it. You want to make sure that that prop is staying healthy and alive, because it doesn't last forever. And if you're using dry yeast, as I know many wineries do, when you rehydrate them and before you inoculate, you would do that same check just to make sure that everything is still good and going, because just seeing the bubbles isn't necessarily an indicator that you have enough viable yeast.
Great.
Other recommendations for lab equipment, breweries and cideries, obviously carbonation is very important. So you should have a ZOM. It is a, well, ZOM is the company. Everyone I know just refers to the piece of equipment as a ZOM, but ZOM is a company and they make a CO2 measurer. So if you're unfamiliar with it, you hook it up to your tank, you run some of the liquid through it, you close off the valves, you shake it, and then you measure the temperature and the pressure. And from that, you can calculate the CO2. So very important to make sure that you are not overcarbonating. And of course, you don't want to be undercarbonating because that has so much to do with your product and how it tastes and appears to customers. Yeah, those are my main ones.
Great. Just yeah. A few. I know.
Just a few.
It sounds like a lot. Again, these are things that become second nature over time.
They do.
And it's a good baseline just to make sure you feel confident in the product that you're putting out. I'm sure nobody that's making something wants to go into people's hands below their own standards. And this is a good place to start. So as a company is growing and maybe beginning to distribute further afield, people who are no longer just selling directly over their own, through their own tasting room, but are starting to get into distribution or especially into kind of maybe up and down the Eastern Seaboard or selling through, if it's possible, selling online, that means the product kind of, the QC measures have to be that much more robust and exacting. So what are some measures that a company might want to consider adding as they're growing? And what are those additional benefits? What are those gains that they can achieve through that? And are there any that don't make sense to bring in-house?
Yeah. Well, one thing I'd say also for really anybody, but especially once you start really growing, is record everything, write everything down. If you don't have records, then you can't troubleshoot later. So write it all down. And as you're growing, you'll be able to look back on those records and see like, okay, this is how we used to do it. We changed our methods and now it's more efficient, but are we still making the same product? That kind of thing is really important. If you're looking to upgrade equipment, you can get a digital density meter instead of using hydrometers. It'll be more accurate and you'll get more consistency from person to person, which is very important. All the industries, a DO meter, so measuring the dissolved oxygen before it goes into package is very important. It'll help you improve your shelf life. Oxygen is very detrimental, especially to beer and cider. Mm-hmm. Little bit is okay for wine, but not too much. You don't want to age it too fast. And the reaction happens almost instantly. So if you are using a DO meter, make sure that you are measuring the tank right before it gets packaged and then the package as it comes off of the line. Don't wait and try and test it a couple hours later, a couple days later. That oxygen is going to bind up and your dissolved oxygen reading is going to be very low and you'll probably be very happy with it, as we all are, but it will be artificially low. So if you are using a DO meter, make sure that you are doing it right off the line. Another upgrade would be starting to do some plating in-house, but certainly that takes a decent amount of skill to do, preparing the media, incubating, figuring out how to read the media and the plates, what it means. But you are able to catch some contamination sooner, which is really good. Wine and cider, you can also do some paper chromatography that'll help with malolactic fermentations, monitoring those. You can start to do some free and total sulfur dioxide testing in-house and stability tests. But each of those does require some more equipment and the knowledge to go with that and how to use everything. How to be safe with the chemicals, how to troubleshoot if something isn't reading correctly, all that kind of thing. I do highly recommend that if you do have a lab, do some outside checking with other producers in your area or an actual third-party lab, just to make sure that your numbers are lining up. And once you get those lined up, great. But I would check in every year or so just to make sure that you haven't drifted. Your chemicals are still good. You haven't picked up a shortcut habit that's actually detrimental. For not in-house, like until you're really ready to hire a full-time lab tech and really equip a lab, I would recommend any PCR for micro, so the DNA testing for micro, sending that out, anything that requires a UV vis spectrophotometer. So that would be colors and acids beyond just doing some of the paper, simple paper chromatography for Lyme. Ciders, IBUs, or then the really important one, YAN. So for everybody, we know that nitrogen is really important for yeast health and development. So you want to make sure that at the beginning of your process, you are measuring the yeast assimilable nitrogen, YAN, so that you know how much you're starting with and you know how much you need to add to get it through the fermentation. Again, there's no magic number here that you can just add, you know, 250 parts every time and you'll be good to go. Some grapes are more likely to have more YAN, some are less likely, but it also depends on when you pick it and harvest. Same thing in beer with the malts and apples and cider. So if you have too much, then your yeast are going to get through fermentation before they deplete the nitrogen. And you are then leaving food behind, essentially. So you may have spoilage microorganisms come in and find a very happy place to be. If you add too little, then your fermentation is probably going to stall. You may start getting some off flavors. You may never complete fermentation. So it's very important to make sure that you really get that nitrogen amount measured at the beginning and have enough in there.
Yeah, and it sounds like that would probably be especially important, like you said, for the cider and wine world because of the inherent variability of freshly harvested fruit.
Right.
In beer, it's a different space to a degree because everything's being produced to a standard, and malt comes with some degree of specs, right? Associated with it. You know, you want to double check to make sure that what you're getting actually matches the spec sheet, but, and it doesn't always, but you know, you never know when you're picking an apple off a tree or a grape off a vine.
Right.
What exactly is in there is important to ascertain before you start putting it through the process.
Yeah. So apples and grapes definitely need to measure. The malt, make sure that you're actually reading your COAs. So your certificate of analysis that comes with every batch. make sure that it's not changing. Make sure that your nutrient add is based off of the numbers that come on that certificate and aren't just kind of arbitrary. We do the same amount no matter the recipe. Because you're blending malt too. So you're gonna have to kind of figure out what is the nitrogen actually for that blend of malt if you're not using 100% of one.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you. So I know we just ran through a bunch of measures and a bunch of jargon. And again, you don't need to walk away from today knowing all of these tests, right? These are just areas to be investigating, to do your homework on, and some of them you may already have in place. There are plenty of resources out there, which we'll talk about on the back end, but thinking about how to incorporate this into your business that's really what I'm hoping that you all will take away. So I know it would be really helpful to kind of go through, Audrey, if you don't mind just sharing what a good SOP, a QAQC protocol, right? Just how do you enshrine this within a company? Everybody who's in this space has probably had labor. You know, they're aware that their staffing may turn over in time. Being able to hand this off from one person to the next, assuring interbatch reliability, those types of things. So, how can a company think about standing up a QA/QC protocol?
Know your processes, know when to test for each product. If you're unsure, ask. My company, Imbibe, is happy to help you with designing and executing a testing system, as well as how to track data and really talk to you about how to put any of that together. But once you have kind of down what your processes are, when you're going to do testing, create that consistent SOPs that what you just said, anyone and everyone can follow. The worst SOP I have ever seen was pull the sample and take it to Amy. I'm like, I don't know who Amy is. Amy doesn't work.
That is not great. And then, yeah.
And then what is Amy going to do with it?
Yeah. I will say it is definitely important to make sure that each step has a person associated with it. That person has a backup, people are being trained and all that, but it can't be.
But put the job title instead of the person's name.
Sure.
At the very least of like, Amy is in the lab. So take the sample to the lab. Okay. Why am I taking the sample to the lab? Take the sample to the lab for pH and TA.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
That is a little clearer. So each step, right, making it clear when it happens, how often it happens, if this is an every batch thing, if this is a monthly check or whatever, the person or either the role associated with it, who the backup might be, if that person has left or if there's ideally there's no mission critical function that is assigned to a specific person who has not trained up another person on it, because they'll leave for all kinds of reasons and it can't be, we're not going to do that anymore. Our person who runs pH left.
Right. Or, if it's, for whatever it is, say specifically why you are, if you're taking it to somebody, who you're taking it to. And then make it so that if there is no person there anymore, you can find the SOP to run the test you need, or, how to run the pump, or how to do a transfer of, somebody's out sick. It's now your job to do the transfer. And while you've been working in the tasting room for 2 years and it's been a while, have that SOP you can go back to. Make sure that your SOPs can kind of link together so that there is the overall flow, but then there's also the individual components. So in theory, anyone could come in and run your production. So it's huge. I know it's a lot of work. It's intimidating. Start by writing the first one and just write them as you do them of like, okay, today I am running the pump. So step one, plug it in. and literally please put step one, plug it in. Turn it on. People forget that. And they can't figure out why it won't turn on because it's not plugged in. I know it's really simple, but SOPs are meant to be the most basic, straightforward. Someone with no experience can come in and do it.
That is
very, very important.
It is a very good point. And I should say, I like the point about interlinking SOPs, because there's maybe, SOPs that will follow through the product on testing, but then for each tests or each step along the way, there needs to be an SOP associated with that given test. And depending on how much, how savvy you might be and what kind of platform you're putting these in, you can literally interlink them where it says, now is the point where we take pH, and then you can hyperlink to that next document. So you follow the chain literally just by clicking through. It doesn't have to be that. It could be on a clipboard somewhere, but making sure even though you know where the SOPs lie, because they should evolve over time. If you improve your process or if something about your production changes, I'll say, for instance, I know plenty of companies that have expanded and where they keep equipment changes. And it can be very frustrating when they say, well, somebody moved the meter. I don't know where it is anymore. So these should be living documents. They should be constantly updated, and there should be revision histories. So if you are making a change because you have improved something, the way that you're measuring something is different, a recipe has changed, and therefore you should be seeing different numbers or whatever. Having at the bottom of every SOP, a revision history, who made the change on what date and the rationale for that change. Because it can be very frustrating when things don't piece together the way that they used to. So I know, again, this all sounds like a lot, but the first step is just walk through the process and document it as you go along.
Yeah, it is very intimidating, but it is good to keep up on and review them, make sure that it is still accurate, make sure that nobody has changed anything, because it should be a living document. But I know it's also the last thing that most of us think about, because whatever we're doing, we're so used to doing it. But yeah, revision history, very important.
Yeah. And I know it's something that you have stressed repeatedly in conversations, is that, you know, this is also about the sort of cleaning aspect of things. This is also not just about following the product through, but something you mentioned on the QA side of things, right, is this comes down to having a clean facility that is fully operational. So the same has to go for all of the sort of before you even begin producing your product and running tests on your raw materials and things like that. So,
right. Making sure that you have clean equipment, making sure that everything is getting cleaned uniformly. I've been working with one brewer who had a diastaticus contamination, and we couldn't find it. His cleaning protocol was impeccable looking over it. And it was because he had a new hire who cleaned the spray ball with a hose instead of chemicals.
That will do it.
Living inside of the spray ball where you can't see anything. You know, so making sure that your SOPs are as thorough as the spray ball, the tri-clamps, the, you know, gaskets, everything needs to get cleaned, and listing it out so people don't skip steps. So yeah, clean equipment, maintaining it regularly, and also do sensory kind of throughout your process. You know your products really well. You're going to know when something goes wrong. I have one client who just brought something in that it had just started fermenting, and he could tell it was starting to sour already. Mm. It had some kind of micro in it, and I smelled it. I couldn't smell anything, but you know, it's not my product. He had made it just so consistently year after year that he could pick up on there's something in here and it's not even finished fermenting.
That's really interesting. I mean,
it's really cool.
Yeah. To see,
it's but
yeah, it's not a fun problem to encounter, but it's a great point of just saying, you know, ideally, you know, your products and processes so well that even if you can't pinpoint where something has gone wrong, doing these sensory tests, you know, something is, if you're seeing the fermentation lag, if something's up, it's worth going through and putting the numbers to it to confirm the suspicions. Because 90% of the time, if something doesn't feel right, there's a good reason for that. And right. You may not know why. And that's part of it, is of these processes, is to determine the why, not just the what, right? Yes,
yep.
It is. The pH is off. What went wrong?
Why? Yeah, because if there's something in there that's going to stay in the tank, you know, we need to make sure that we find it before you put something else in the tank, that kind of thing.
Yes.
You know, absolutely. Or if the contaminant is in one of your raw ingredients, you know, there's something in there, like you better trace it back to that raw ingredient before you start using it again and something else, or cross pitching, or,
sure.
You know, it doesn't matter how much you plan. We can write all the SOPs we want. Some things are just not going to fit in that mold. And so you have to be really adaptable and be willing to take that breath and say, like, okay, let's figure this out.
Yeah, no, that's a great point. You know, you control what you can. Mm-hmm. This is, you know, you're dealing with agricultural products. So there's always going to be externalities. I mean, you're producing in a large building that has all kinds of things, temperature changes, all the, you know, there's things you can't control. So doing everything you can to reduce the variability so that you can, I don't know, assure the best possible product. It's really important.
And exactly.
With the SOP things, something that I just want to hammer home one more time is train your people. It does no good to have SOPs that aren't being used or aren't being handed down and trained all the way through. You know, even if somebody is the fourth in line for, you know, handling some tests, well, if you're all out at a conference and you bring your person and something goes wrong, they need to, you need to have somebody who can handle something, because if it can mean the difference between a product, you know, meeting your standards or not, is really important. So train your people, you know, make sure everybody knows what's up so that when something goes wrong too, you can say, hey, here's the SOPs. It was right here. Why did you do it that way? You know, that's the way it comes down sometimes, you know, people only can do what they're trained to do.
And that's kind of the difference between like implicit knowledge, explicit, like, you know it certainly, but make sure that you say it so that everybody knows it. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Consistency is important from person to person, whether it's beer and you're trying to be really consistent, or it's wine and you have a new harvest and you're making a new wine, you still need your employees to be doing the same thing every time.
Yeah. Well, I guess the last question for now, before I open it up to Q&A, do you have any tips or resources for companies that are looking to either stand up or improve their QA QC program?
Sure. First tip would be keep a library. Make sure that you are keeping a case of everything you make so that if a customer comes back and starts complaining, you can go open a can or bottle and see, like, you know, is it in yours as well? Do you need to send it out for testing? You know, you can have some references. In the beer and cider world, you can also use some of those to do heat testing. So warm it up, you get some expedited aging data, make sure that things are stable. So keeping a library really helps with troubleshooting later down the line. I would say do kind of accuracy, precision, and efficiency tests on a regular basis, like at least every year. So we just talked about people, but also then processes and equipment. Use standards if you're doing any kind of lab tests. Make sure you have some internal standards that you're using, so you can be consistent in what you're doing. And I just set a reminder kind of on your calendar for whenever your slow season is. Okay, it's time to, if you have pipettes, send the pipettes in for calibration, you know, clean everything. It's time to change out all those gaskets. Just set a reminder on your calendar to go off every year in your slow season and just do it. It's annoying, but do it. If you have any questions about processes, ask other producers, ask suppliers, reach out to the lab. Imbibe is always happy to talk with you about kind of your processes, or if you have questions. Really, the industry is so wonderful because people are so open about sharing, you know, oh shoot, I had this issue. People will willingly say, I fucked up, I had a problem, and you know, this is what I've learned, this is how you can not do that. It's a great community. Use it, embrace it. For beer resources, I would definitely look into the MBAA, the Master Brewers Association of the Americas. They are an educational organization. They do a lot of classes. They have a quarterly journal that goes out. So there's a lot of research. If you have any questions, sciencey, or processing, they're really good. Science, I would look at the ASBC. It's the American Society of Brewing Chemists. Obviously, it's going to be all science. There's a lot of information there to dig through, but they are very helpful with that. If you're ever looking at wanting to set up sensory panels, really across the board in the industries, the sensory panel organization or setup that they have is very well organized. And could work for everyone. For wine, UC Davis is great, as are other universities, but UC Davis has some really nice classes you can take. and they put out a lot of publications, just free information. That's awesome. As does the Australian Wine Research Institute. They are a lab in Australia, so they're always doing research, but they post a lot of it for free. So if you have questions about SO2, for example, they have a really great paper on SO2 and kind of what you should target, molecular SO2, if you're interested in looking at that and how to do it. Cider Cornell is a really great university, lots of resources, lots of papers. Again, there are plenty of universities for everybody on this one. Also, the Northwest Cider Association has a cider maker's toolkit that is really useful. And that's everything from the science side of it, to the process side of it, to working with trees, to marketing. They really cover their expanse. So I would, depending on your industry, look at those if you have any questions. And then of course, you're more than welcome to reach out to us, and we're happy to go over anything that we can help with.
That's great. Thank you, Audrey. I appreciate you running through that. There's a ton of information that's out there. And once you start looking and asking these questions, it's just an enormous amount of information. You can always reach out to us at the SBDC, and at the very least, I'm not the expert, but part of what we do is just making sure you have all these things at your fingertips too. So I will say one of the things that I find myself saying over and over again is nothing you will encounter will you be the first person to encounter. These, people have been around for a while in these industries. It's very rare that something new happens now, especially on this QAQC front. Somebody has faced it, and chances are somebody has already shared their experience. So don't get too worried about that front. There's lots of information about people who have dealt with this exact same thing. So yeah, you are not alone.
Yeah, exactly.
And so with that, I'm going to see if anybody has any questions before we finish up our presentation today. So if you have any questions, go ahead and type them in the Q&A box. And unless we see anything come in, I'll say thank you, Audrey, for your time and your expertise. I know this is just scratching the surface, but it's a really important area. And it's, as Virginia's breweries, wineries, and cideries, the industries are maturing more and more every year, it's just that much more important just to be a competitive and viable company to have these things in place. So I really appreciate you sharing your time and expertise.
Well, thank you for inviting me. I enjoy talking about this, as you can tell, and it is a lot of information, and it's a lot to cover and remember, but it's important. It is very important to know. So I'm always glad to talk about it.
Thank you so much. And thank you all for tuning in.
Yeah, thanks. I just want to let everybody know you'll all receive an email with a link to this recording. If you'd like to sign up for upcoming webinars or access recorded webinars, please visit virginiasbdc.org/training. These resources are designed to be used in collaboration with your local SBDC advisors. So you can sign up for a free and confidential session by emailing help@virginiasbdc.org or via our website. So thank you so much. Thanks, Chris and Audrey, and thank you everyone for attending today.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.